So good morning, everyone. I hope you've all got your coffees and recovered from last night's festivities. We're here to talk about the future of music brand and media partnerships, and we've literally got 15 to 20 minutes to solve that rather large problem. Jenny, your title, we had a little bit of a chat before we come up here. Explain what your title means and also what's your role?
Yeah, I get this question all the time, actually. So the content partnerships team, we work with content providers and publishers throughout the world. So that's TV networks, film companies, music entities, sports organizations, all of the big kind of top tier content publishers. And we develop content campaigns with them that we often then turn into sponsorship campaigns, which brands can come in and sponsor, which obviously increases reach and revenue for the publishing partners and also for the advertisers. So that's pretty much what our team does.
Okay. And the word content, do you actually like the word content? Because I don't. I think content fills up a bucket.
I think it's
more entertainment.
Yeah, exactly. I agree with you. I like entertainment. I think it's one of those words like influencer, which is kind of one of those buzzwords a little bit of the moment. But it is a content game. Content is king,
content
as everybody
is king.
Wants to
content
say.
Is king. But, okay, so let's talk a little bit about Twitter and what's happening in the company. Obviously, content, your role's hugely important. What's the overall strategy? Where's this going for you guys?
Yeah, we are right now in a position where we are aggressively continuing to invest in content. Publishers on our platform are making more money than they ever have before. Advertisers are coming more to the platform than they ever have before. So we are going to continue to invest in that area. That means, again, working with top content publishers throughout the world. What we are not doing is we're not trying to be like a Netflix. We're not looking at streaming, long form, self-produced custom content. We're really working with our partners to surface the best content that they already have and are already producing, and we're just bringing more eyeballs to that content. And we're also just going to continue to invest in live and live streaming on the platform.
Yeah, and I think it's probably time to reflect a little bit on what Sony Music's doing in this space, because obviously we're working together towards a partnership. And the way we're changing our marketing department, just recently, we've basically put on, I think, 5 video editors. We've brought in script writers. We've brought in a lot more sort of social media people. And generally, our move is towards the marketing budget being 40% on content. And are you seeing similar things, in the industry?
Look, I'm not just saying this because you're here, but we absolutely love working with Sony. I mean, Sony has always been such an innovative partner of ours, and you guys have always been willing to take a chance and do big things and kind of just go for it. And we love that in a partner. We love being able to call somebody up and say, hey, we have this idea, what do you guys think, and workshop that together. And Sony has always been a great partner of ours that way. So I think that comparatively, at least from our experience, you guys absolutely lean in a bit more than other organizations. I think in general, the music industry took a little bit longer to kind of adjust to this place where we're at now. News, TV, sport, those all kind of happened first, and then music kind of started to come around after. And some of that is obviously because of rights issues and distribution and those sort of things. But I think now we're at a stage where music has caught up and is continually doing innovative things.
Yeah, I think there was also a point there too where artists, if you go back sort of almost 5 to 7 years, artists weren't as conscious of creative content. They would create a music video, and then they would sit back and put it up, and that would be done. We're looking at some of the artists now. We've got, I was just talking to Gunnar, who runs Liquid State. The Faded track, when they put they did one music video, and I think there was another 75 pieces of content around that music video. So artists are really starting to try it. They're really understanding this now. The best ones actually are doing stuff without us even engaging with them.
Yeah.
They're moving ahead of the curve rather than waiting for the music company to catch up with them.
Yeah, absolutely. We see that all the time. And we actually have Alan Walker and Cascade coming to our Blue Room here in Singapore later today, where they're both doing Q&As. And you're right, like, we've done so many innovative things together. We've done a lot of VIP fan experiences where we have Twitter competitions and they win tickets to come in and go to a very intimate fan experience where they see a stripped back performance from the artist. We did, you know, Delta Goodrum together and the Chainsmokers and a lot of them over the last couple of years, and they always trend at number one around the world. They always drive a huge amount of video views and engagement. We see a massive, about 3 times more engagement when we do these things. So we know that they work. We did one with Meghan Trainor together, and she loved it so much that she produced her own video about it, which we have somewhere. Can we show that video? So just really great ways to bring artists and their fans closer together and to give them a unique experience that they remember, but also making things blow up on the platforms as well.
Yeah, because like, let's go back a little bit. Let's talk about that Delta Goodrum VIP event. What was the results of that? Just to give people an indication about what was achieved.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, when you guys came to us, it was about giving her more exposure outside of Australia. And so we were able to make that event trend all over the world. It trended in all of the major countries and cities everywhere in the world. She saw up to 5 times the amount of normal engagement that she sees on the platform and impressions. It was trending everywhere that you can think of. So it had great results, and we just want to, you know, keep doing that for music artists. And to your point, they're doing things without even working with us. If we're seeing trailers be premiered for music videos, we're seeing impromptu Q&As that they just host on their own. We did another great event together in India recently where we did an event with the 7-Up Madras gig. I'm very familiar with that one. So we're doing this not just in Australia, but all over Asia Pacific together, and we're just really excited to kind of keep growing the partnership.
Yeah, so we've covered off sort of how the artists are getting involved and how they're understanding how they market themselves and getting the content out there. So let's talk about the advertisers and the brands now. Let's break it down there. So what are the advertisers and brands? What are you hearing from them, and what do they want from this content?
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's 2 main things. One request that we get time and time again is customization, so custom content. So anytime an artist is a little bit more flexible about, and it always has to feel organic, right? Like, you can't just put a product into an artist's hand, and that's really true for any talent, and try to make it work. Like, it has to be a natural fit.
Absolutely.
But I think that when you do have that natural fit and that partnership, that is definitely something that the brands are always asking for.
Yep.
And then it's no secret, obviously, that they want their audience. They want that music artist's audience. So, you know, they're looking a little bit less sometimes at the content and more at, well, who is actually the fan of that artist.
Okay. And, you know, obviously working with Sony Music, I think one of the things that, you know, we're providing you with is the breakdowns of the artist DNAs, their fan backgrounds.
Yeah.
So that's all useful. When we're coming to you, we're actually explaining who this artist really is and who the fan base is.
And also their interest outside of music is really helpful. So when we know that you might have a music artist, but they're really into sport, for example, or they're really into cooking, that then helps us figure out the brands that will be that natural organic fit, and that's really helpful too.
Yeah, yep, absolutely. Okay, let's have a little talk about, you know, the scale. Let's talk about the scale. So What are you seeing? How small could it be, and how big can it be, and is there sort of a perfect size?
Yeah. One of my favorite, I think, recent examples was from South by Southwest earlier this year, where we actually did a huge partnership between Twitter and South by Southwest, and then also with Sounds Australia, the Australia house, But one thing that was really interesting, thinking about like a smaller scale campaign, was that there was an artist there named G-Flip, who people probably know now, but no one really knew at the time. And she was very smart, and she journeyed her whole video, a whole video journey to South by Southwest, and she put that out on social media and saw that it had instant results. And then that then caused her to just start using Twitter more and more and more and more, and starting producing more videos because she saw that engagement and saw the results. And it's just led to her creating a huge fan base on Twitter. And that's an artist that still is not, you know, massive around the world, but she saw the power that the platform,
the benefit of, yeah,
that. And I think South By is a really good example of that, and the power that it has with indie artists, and how we can sort of help them get recognition around the world.
Mm-hmm. And are there any particular brands that stand out? Like, are there brands that are really coming to you, they're hungry, leaning forward to take really creative, innovative things? Is there any particular ones that you think?
Gosh, there's so many around the world, it would be hard to call out one or two. It's also really different for each market. We do obviously have some global brand partnerships, but what we see, you know, in Korea is going to be really different with partners that we might see in Australia. So
yeah, sure.
It's hard to kind of mention one or two.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So in terms of, you know, the content, the content play, how is Twitter unique? Because obviously, there's competitors. This content can go in a lot of places.
Yeah.
What are you guys doing that actually makes it so unique?
Yeah. Everything. I think there's a combination of things. Like, we, again, partner with the top content providers and publishers in the world, and we're very unique in that sense. So, for example, through Asia Pacific, we work on a partnership basis with all of the major television broadcasters through the region. So we're really focusing in on a select group of content partners, which we know are serving the organic conversation on our platform. So we're not looking so much for very niche events, I would say, where you do see on other platforms a lot of kind of niche broadcasting or custom content creation. We're not creating our own content. We're not producing our own content. And we're also just serving the organic conversation which already exists on the platform.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that we're seeing with Twitter particularly is you guys are really leaning forward to us. There's other platforms that sort of they're quite happy to take the content and put it up. But we're seeing that you guys are really actively coming to us and looking for opportunities. Is that the culture? Is that coming? That's coming right from the top?
Yeah, we hear that a lot from our partners, actually, that the level of service and that collaboration is actually a true partnership. And that's why the partnerships that we have been over several years, we've worked together for 4 years now, which that just continues to develop because we do hear that a lot, that we are very leaned in. But we do take the word partnership very seriously. We do think that it's a two-way street, and it's a constant working relationship to work it out together what works best.
Okay. Is there anything particularly, you just mentioned countries. The amount of data you've got to work out what countries are firing. What is there any one country that maybe is stands out as something interesting or happening?
Come on, K-pop, there is no secret that K-pop is taking over the world. And just this past weekend, we had the Hallyu Pop Festival here, and that had 770,000 tweets in just 3 days. We saw close to a billion tweets last year about K-pop. So it's completely taken over the world. You look at BTS, GOT7,
yeah,
all of these bands. We've spoken about this before.
Yeah.
I see my amazing partnerships manager for Korea sitting here. She does an incredible job. The scope and scale of K-pop and the rate at which it's growing and has grown in the last year is just mind-blowing. But for us in general, Asia Pacific is a huge region of growth, and the whole region is growing at a really rapid scale, and that's why we're continuing to invest in APAC specifically as well.
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned Korea. We've got our Urbanax now wanting to go to Korea,
yeah,
just so that they can get a tweet with BTS. And we had one recently, I think it was like 400,000 in 24 hours. It was like, it's unbelievable.
The requests that we get all the time from our global counterparts about, hey, can you get this K-pop band to do something for us? It's everybody wants a piece of it right now, right?
Yeah, that's great. Okay, so we've talked about the music industry, but like, what about, you know, this partnership model that you have?
Yeah.
You know, how, obviously you're working with the major players, but how far down does it go? Do you guys start to sort of target, you know, like, influences in certain countries as well? Is that where you're going to be heading?
We do. We do have influencer relationships. We actually have a partner a section of our company called Niche, which works directly with influencers. We're beginning to scale Niche throughout APAC now. But in addition to having the Niche group, we do also work individually with influencers throughout the region. That kind of is dependent on each market. So each market approaches it a little bit differently. We work with a lot of influencers through Asia Pacific, but again, it's kind of managed by different teams and different things. But it's certainly an area that we're continuing to invest in. Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, if we're looking forward a couple of years, you know, I was talking about, you know, the way we're changing our model. You know, the music video is part of our marketing mix now, but we're doing so much more content. We're creating, you know, a content team inside of that rather than actually, you know, going to creative agencies. We're building that in-house. We're going to be rolling that out across the region for Sony Music. It's a really interesting time, and it will actually change the style of people that we're actually employing, you know, because you actually need good people that can run animation, you know, to make the really high-quality content. So we've actively seen that's the direction we want to go. Do you think that, you know, do you see sort of agencies going in, you know, that direction? Do you think that some of this stuff will be brought in-house? Because if it's such a core part of your marketing approach, you know, does that just become part of your company as opposed to, so it will have an impact on the industry at all?
Yeah, I absolutely think so. We're seeing this. I think you guys are ahead of the game. And again, it's one of the reasons why we're so excited to continue the partnership with you guys. But we are seeing these kind of content teams pop up in organizations now. I mean, I was on the phone with a friend who actually used to work for Facebook, and he's now heading up the content team at Goldman Sachs, which is bizarre. So, you know, you're seeing all these content teams pop up in less traditional companies as well. But I think it all comes back to, it has to be top quality content. There has to be an advertiser interest that is focused to that audience. So what we have seen doesn't work is when we've tried to work with talent and content that we think is great, but then we realize there isn't actually any advertiser demand for it, and that kind of doesn't work for anybody, you know. So we've gotten better at assessing that advertiser demand for our partners as well, and really zoning in on what will work for both sides and what will hit the objectives and the goals for both the advertiser and the partner.
Okay. So where do you think we'll be? So from sort of 2 or 3 years time from now, what will the changes we see, particularly in your role? What thing do you think you might be doing, and what were the changes at Twitter? If we sort of just look, if you'd be futuristic.
Yeah. One thing that's really interesting is there was a e-marketer research article a couple weeks ago that said that by 2020 there'll be more than 1 billion digital video viewers in Asia Pacific.
Wow.
That speaks volumes to how important this region is, right? And how quickly we're growing. So I think, you know, I love the chaos. The beautiful chaos of APAC and how crazy it is and the differences and all of the cultures and the geography. So, you know, I would love to keep diving into Asia Pacific and helping to grow the region. And I think for Twitter, again, it's our focus is clearer. I've been with the company for 4 years. It's clearer now than it's ever been before. Like,
really, yeah, it feels that way too.
It really is.
Very clear.
Like, really doubling down on video and live, and again, serving the conversation that's already there. And I think we'll just continue to do that because it is working for both our publishers and our advertisers.
Yeah. So we've got a partnership. This might be an announcement tonight, I believe. Obviously, we're really excited that Guy Sebastian, one of our top line Australian acts, is going to be involved in the first part of that partnership. He's going to be doing some very interesting content pieces about reflecting back on his. He's been in the industry for many years, but the content pieces will be him reflecting back on his first few videos, which is quite crazy actually. Because if you know Guy Sebastian, he used to have a head of hair about this big. So. It's simple. It's simple content, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's engaging, but it's not overly complex. That's the great thing, isn't it?
I think that's a really great point. Is often people come to us and they think they have to be producing something really special and, you know, extraordinary. And a lot of times it's content that you may already have sitting around and you just haven't done anything with it, or you don't know how to use that content on Twitter. And so we help you figure that out. Other times it just takes a simple idea like this, where again, doesn't necessarily take a huge amount of time from the artist or a huge production team or anything. It's easy to execute, and we can workshop those ideas together. And again, that's where it comes into this being a true partnership, where we don't come to you and say, hey, you know, this is what we want you to do, or this is what we think will work for your artist. Like, you guys helped us shape that idea, and we figured out together, you know, what was going to work. So it absolutely doesn't have to be something, you know, over the top difficult or expensive or anything else.
No, I think actually some of the best pieces of content that our most users, the ice bucket challenge.
Yeah.
It's like literally tipping a bucket of ice over your head and actually got solid views where we've, and we put a lot of effort into something else and got nowhere. So
video and it'll do really well.
So let's talk about everyone's favorite topic, which is gaming.
Yeah.
How's gaming impacting on Twitter?
Yeah, gaming is so huge. We've seen a lot of growth with gaming over the last couple of years. We have a great partnership with some gaming providers, which you'll see more of in the next few months. It's certainly an area that we're continuing to invest in. So it's still really good. So really important. We're also expanding into things like lifestyle food content has been really growing on the platform. Fashion obviously continues to be an area that we're investing in. So we take the term entertainment, you know, very loosely.
Very, very broad.
Yeah.
Okay, Jen, I think we're practically out of time here. So any closing remarks just to sort of wrap things up? Or obviously we're really excited about our partnership.
Yes.
We're planning to do a lot more with you guys over the next 12 months.
Yeah.
Anything to close?
We are super excited as well. We are doing a big event tonight, lots of big announcements, which I know you'll be at, but for anyone in the room that has a conference pass, you are actually able to come into the event tonight, so I encourage you guys to come if you're still here. It's at 4 p.m. But in general, just really excited to keep working together.
Okay, well, thanks very much for your time.
Thanks,
appreciate
Seth.
It.